WCW nWo Revenge, the sequel to World Tour, was released in November 1988 by THQ AKI. Well, I guess it's actually pronounced Aki. I always said AKI because it's right there next to another three-letter name. And it's THQ, not Tuk. Anyway, I've talked before about game series that released sequels that barely improved or even got worse. Not so at Revenge. This is the peak of WCW gaming and close to the peak of wrestling gaming period. Everything that was good was carried over from World Tour, and everything that needed improvement was done in leaps and bounds. Look at the intro video. In World Tour, you just had the giant yelling gibberish at Hulk Hogan until Sting came down from the rafters. But Revenge has its own little mini-movie. Let's break this down. Dateline, Atlanta, Georgia, 1998. It's a dark and stormy night, and we see an 18-wheeler traveling down the road. Apparently the programmers felt it was very important to establish this fact, so we see 40 friggin' seconds of this truck. Then a barrel catches fire, lightning strikes, and Sting appears in the road. The driver slams on the brakes, says, "What?" and then we cut away. What happens next? Why did Sting stop the truck? I have no idea. My pet theory is that this is a WWF ring truck driving through WCW territory, so Sting, I don't know, hijacked it or something. Or maybe he had to hitchhike to the arena. In any case, the music kicks in and we move on to Hulk Hogan standing in the dark, apparently having his heart monitored. Then we see a lot of clips of main adventures with words like hot and live flashing on the screen. Cut to Sting looking over the bay of some city as the giant Bret Hart and the Hulkster appear in the sky. Then we kick into the second part and see a bunch of mid-cards hitting their patented moves. I remember seeing this clip online in the summer of 1998 and my mind melted. It must have sucked to be a guy like Jim Neidhart when you're shown getting your ass kicked by Buff Bagwell. Anyway, we cut back to Sting, who's having a seizure. Hulk Hogan is now spontaneously combusted, and again judging by his heart rate, he's pretty cool about it. Then he and Sting face off, shoot laser eye beams at each other, and everything explodes. Then the game starts. Kind of want to end the review right there, but we should soldier on. We can break this down into what's the same, better, and new. Starting with the same, they thankfully carried over the engine from World Tour. If you play that, you'll pick this up no problem. But THQ made a couple of important tweaks. First, when you're in a front grapple, if you hit the R button, you switch to a rear grapple. This was big, since in World Tour, if you wanted a rear grapple, you had to knock a guy down, pick them up, and turn them around, which is a huge pain for specials. Also, you can hop over a downed opponent, which sounds silly, but it's actually another big deal. Since in World Tour, sometimes if you tried to go to the top rope, you wasted a few precious seconds going around your downed opponent. Or sometimes your opponent would inadvertently be blocking you, and you couldn't get to the top rope at all. As for what's better, well, take all of my nitpicks from the last review, and they've been fixed. The graphics are much more detailed, and the wrestlers look great. It's worth noting World Tour came out very early in the N64's lifespan. So for Revenge, the programmers had a much better idea of the system's capabilities. Sounds still aren't much, but you get Randy Savage saying, "Oh, yeah!" The main game mode is Championship mode. Well, there were no titles present at all in World Tour, the goal this time is to win every title. Basically, you pick a championship, World, US, TV, Cruiser, or Tag, and then defeat 10 wrestlers or teams to win that title. Doing so unlocks a wrestler for each belt. Roddy Piper for the World, Kurt Hennig for the US, Kidman for the Cruiser, Canyon for the TV title, and the Faces of Fear for the tag belts. It's kind of funny Piper, Canyon, Meng, and Barbarian never held those belts, but whatever. But what's fun is that after you win a belt, the computer actually keeps track of who the champ is. If you go back and win the title with another wrestler, the game stores them as a champ. I dug my copy of Revenge out after a few years, and here's my championship roster. Booker T was the World Champ, Buff Bagwell the US Champ, Steiner's the Tag Champs, Ultimo Dragon the Cruiser Champ, and Dean Malenko in his 6 years TV Champ. Take that, RVD. That was always weird in the sense that I would never have anyone win a title that wouldn't win it in real life. The Parker wouldn't win the WCW title, so I couldn't bring myself to do it in the game. This didn't stop my college roommate from having Lodi win every title while I was cramming for finals. And speaking of Lodi, with one notable exception, everyone is in the game. It's one thing to have Hulk Hogan, Randy Savage, Kevin Nash, Goldberg, Bret Hart, and all the big names. It's quite another to have Yuji Nagata, Van Hammer, Larry Zbyszko, and Sick Boy. With unlockable wrestlers, there are 60 WCW competitors in the game. There are main eventers, cruiserweights, The Flock, Saturday Night Refugees. Oh, and there are managers in the game, too. Dusty Rhodes, Jimmy Hart, Sonny Ono, and more. And if you're fighting someone with a manager, if you want, you can go out and lay a whooping on them during a match. The only big name missing is Ric Flair, who was having legal troubles with WCW at the time, which is quite a shame. What about the Japanese wrestlers? Well, they're back, sort of. There are wrestlers based on Japanese competitors, but I guess THQ got cold feet, since they changed the names and appearances of the wrestlers, leaving only movesets intact. Their wrestlers based on folks from All Japan and FMW, but they're given goofy names like Maya Inka Boy and Dr. Frank. I like some of the moves, but I never use them much. But I didn't mind them being there, since there were so many other WCW folks to use. Another of my complaints for World Tour was the poorly rendered finishers. Not a problem this time. Everyone's finisher looked spot on. Giant does a big choke slam, Kevin Nash does more of a dropping power bomb, and Diamond Dallas Page has three versions of the Diamond Cutter. But the British Bulldogs has a pretty strange looking power slam, continuing the proud video game tradition of that move just being poorly animated. Maybe my biggest complaint about World Tour was that it didn't really feel like a WCW game. Not so here. Now we have actual WCW sets. Nitro, Starcade, Halloween Havoc, and more. They're expertly rendered. There are entrances now too, although everyone just comes out to the old Nitro theme or some other music. But WCW music was never overly memorable to me, barring the Slam Jam album, of course, so it didn't bother me. But they get so many details right, both in moves. Kevin Nash does a framing elbow in the corner, Scott Hall pauses before his blockbuster suplex, as well as graphical touches. DDP's ribs are taped, cartoon Mark Curtis counts pinfalls, Chris Jericho has 1,004 written on his tights, La Parka starts every match with a chair. This is the ultimate WCW experience. All that's missing is Larry Zbyszko saying, "New World Odor." THQ also introduced a few new things, some good, some bad, some pointless. There's now an edit mode. Not create a wrestler per se, but you can edit the names and outfits of anyone on the roster. This was the era of NWO Hollywood and Wolfpack, so this feature was very handy as you could swap between red and white NWO shirts. And if you want to make Yuji Nagata and Larry Zbyszko the new Harlem Heat, hey, go for it. They also had instant replays, both in-match and afterwards. If you hit a big move during a match, you'll see the impact replayed quickly from three different angles before resuming to action. And the end of every match is repeated on a loop, great for taunting your friends. There's a new striking feature for certain guys like Goldberg, Yuji Nagata, Glacier, and Ultimo Dragon. Or if you strong grappled and hit B, you'd be able to hit six strikes in a row, using the direction pad and B button. I was never a big fan of this. It took away half your grapples, now it does get reversed in the end. You also get scored after the match in a variety of categories, and you can compete for high scores. I didn't care about this, and I don't know anyone who did either. You won the match, why do you have to get graded on it? The last new feature was Battle Royal mode. The way this was set up was you could do a standard four-way, or you could have up to 40 wrestlers, with a new one coming out when someone was eliminated. Eliminations could be by pinfall, going to the floor, or both. I think senior year of college is defined for me by these epic matches with four players. If someone got tossed, they would assume control of whoever came out next. This was good for a laugh when someone came out as Reese or Maya Inka Boy. I have no real complaints, other than wrestlers sometimes pop right back up when you hit a special move. If you nail someone with a Macho Man elbow, they shouldn't get up right away. Unless it's a famous reviving elbow drop. Sometimes wrestlers will do a run-in on your match, and try to do a handicap bout until you fight them off, which is an interesting idea, but always elicited groans when it happened. If you were a fan of WCW, how could you not own this game? Even though the series got better, it's worth picking up since there are so many wrestlers not present later, due to THQ switching licenses. But we'll get to that next time. As for WCW, as far as gaming, it was all downhill from here. Boy, was it ever a steep hill. Till next time, thanks for watching, and remember, a winner is you.